And then I know you mentioned with Christian the most satisfying moment. I want to ask, what do you think is the most difficult part? I know you went from selling clams to writing a poem to sell to in a car shop, writing a book about a car shop. So is there a moment in your life where you're like, wow, this is really tough and I don't know if I can come back from this?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. In the early 1980s, I had this idea, you know, all my stories are long stories. I'll try to make this one sort of compact and get to the point of it all. I started a company with a friend of mine to develop computer simulations for education. And we used the Commodore 64 as the platform, which had 64K of RAM or ROM or whichever one of those it was, because I didn't know anything about computers, but my partner Larry Boyd did. But I knew about this vision of what I wanted to do, which was to teach everything to children with this powerful, powerful tool of simulations. So we started a little company and we morphed out of some kind of big stuff that needed $1 million worth of computers, which, you know, we couldn't raise. We had a third partner. We bought him out for a dollar. I like these dollar deals, right? And the vision was to provide these incredible potential tools for children to learn things in their own way, in their own pace, and do it in a real way, right? So as a demonstration, we created a game about the voyage of the Mayflower, which is a central story in American life. And I did a lot of the research working with the Plymouth Plantation in Massachusetts, reading about the Mayflower. It was a ship that had to be supplied. And so we had to figure out the food rations and the animals, and all of that was designed for 16th century animals. We worked with the naval architecture people at the U of M for the sailing characteristics of the ship. We did the weather algorithms and the sea currents. It was a major intellectual effort on my part and on Larry's part. We even had 16th century music, and I mean, he was a brilliant programmer. He still is. and this was the great dream. This was the best idea that I ever had. And I was also working as a carpenter, you know, swinging a hammer all day and then trying to find enough money to get this little thing off the ground. And we finally did all of that. We took it to market. I found $1,500 to run a couple of small ads. I designed the packaging and it was just a whole thing that we invested less than $10,000 in. We had a competitor here in town that got $1 million of Apple money. So that was sort of the scale in that moment. And so we put all this together, and the idea was that this game, The Voyage of the Mayflower, would demonstrate the power of what we were doing. And we were creating a platform on which to add other stories based on sound research where children could learn. And we did demonstrations in schools for that. And kids were fighting over who could get the keyboard. So that was like, you know, testing the market, right? The kids were going, bam, I want to do this, you know, get out of my way. We thought, this is gold. And one morning I got up, and it was in August of that year, I remember. And I realized that we were done. There was no money. I couldn't go anywhere with this. And I looked at this as just a complete failure. We had sold copies of this in many parts of the world. We sold, you know, like, I don't know, a few hundred copies of this little computer game. But the idea was so compelling to me. And I invested all of my soul into this. And got up one morning and realized that it was over. And it was just dark. It was really, really dark. And I was standing outside with my kids who were young. And we had no money, you know, no business, no nothing. And I had this old Oldsmobile car that somebody had given me. And I had about a quarter of a tank of gas in it. And this was like a 400 cubic inch engine. And the 4-H fair was going on, which was free. And I'm standing in front of my house. And literally, there were no colors in my world. It was dark. And I thought, well, I don't know what to do, you know? I just don't know what to do. I was done. And I said, well, okay, what I can do is I can take the kids and go to the 4-H fair. So I did. I took them and went, you know, the last few gallons of gas I had, went to the 4-H fair, and I got there, and they went off to look at the rabbits and the goats. And I'd been working in agriculture, so which is why I knew about the 4-H fair. And so I had a lot of former clients that would show their animals there and bring their kids and all that sort of stuff. So there I am standing there in total despair. And one of my former clients came up to me and he said, Ken, how are you doing? And I just unloaded. You know, I said, I'm totally broke. I just failed absolutely in this business. That was the love of my business life, the biggest idea I've ever had. And I'm going on about this terrible way that I feel. And this guy gets this really odd look. And then he says to me, you know, I really wish I could do what you're doing, but I've been at the gas company for too long now, and I can't get out. And I realized that this guy envied me. This was the lowest point in my life in this realm, and he envied me. And I instantly started to feel better. You know, by the next morning, I was doing some damn thing to make some money, you know, but that was the single darkest moment in all of my business life, was to recognize that the great dream of my life was over at that point, you know. So that's that one, Marsh.
I was a bit confused at the beginning. I was like, is he going to give me some big success story or something? Because the way you worded it, it was like going up a roller coaster. So at least I know I haven't experienced this type of failure in a way yet in my life. So we'll see what happens once I cross that road. But honestly, it's really interesting to see, especially I feel like at that age, around, you said you had kids at the time already, right?
Yeah.
So at that point, you I feel like people think that they have their life figured out at that point.
No, I was in my early 30s.
Yeah.
But here, let me just say this to you, that all of the documentation, all of the software is now in a place called Deep Blue at the University of Michigan. And there's a game librarian that's in charge of that. And you could go and play that game on a Commodore 64. And so the thing is alive in some small way. And just last year, I did a podcast with somebody who wanted to know about the history of simulation games, somebody from the larger game community. And so the failure was a business failure. As an intellectual enterprise, it was, in its own way, a success. I proved the concept. I got to be one of the grandfathers of the computer simulation world. You know, this is more than 40 years ago. And the guy that was interviewing me was playing the game. And I thought, wow, this is really cool. And my children loved the fact that that they could, you know, get the video of that. So one of the things about success and failure is learning how to celebrate whatever successes there are within some other context, you know. For me, and this will be a no surprise to you at all, whatever I'm doing, whether from the view of the world or not, a success or a failure, I can't fail, because all the while that things are going on, no matter how crazy they are in my life, I'm also recording the story. And the worst thing that's going to happen is I'm going to get a story out of this and figure out some way to share it. You know, I'm fortunately, I have, you know, you as victims to share these things with, right? I have my students. So that's where all the, you know, that's sort of how you begin to identify the things important to your life. You begin to identify who you are and how you're going to share that with people. And you know, with any luck at all, you become a better person.
So yeah, that was kind of one of our questions is, you know, why teach it now? And you basically kind of said it. You talk about your success, whether it be successes or failures, and kind of bring it to light and teach students about it, and so they can try to implement it in their lives. And so that's really interesting to hear.
Yeah, it's the old, you know, when you get lemons, you know, make lemonade.
Never made lemonade before.
Well, there you go.
Yeah, so I got to
go ahead.
You can go ahead. Sorry to cut you off.
So I get into the teaching aspect. So what made you decide to go into teaching and giving your experience and sharing your story to the world in a way?
Well, you know, beware when you ask these questions. I didn't realize that for a very long time that some part of me needs to share what little I know. You know, I would learn to do something. For instance, when I was restoring antiques, I ended up teaching classes in how to do that. I had a farm in Nova Scotia, which I failed at utterly. And I got a job teaching small farmers how not to do that. I worked for Michigan State University in their field, in their field work. And, you know, at some point, I didn't have any credentials. I didn't get a bachelor's degree until I was almost 50 years old, because I got thrown out of college. And then life happened. And when I went back to college, there was a program at Eastern Michigan University where I could design my own degree program. And I thought, oh, maybe I could do that. And I was inspired by my mother, who left school in eighth grade in Germany, because girls were not allowed to go to school beyond that in little farming communities. And that bothered her. She was a smart woman. And she decided that she was going to get a high school diploma. So at the age of 68, she got her GED. And I was visiting with her. I was going through a divorce at the time, and you know, I was not real happy. And she told me about this, and I thought, well, crap, if mom can get a high school degree, you know, I could go back and get my bachelor's degree. And I got a little bit of time here and so on. So I went back to school and I found this program. And in order to take this program, I had to make a proposal to the college. And so I wrote something up, you know, in my usual succinct fashion, right? Because I write differently than I speak, you know, like one page is a lot for me if I'm going to write something. You know, 5 hours when I'm talking is nothing. So I write up this proposal. I go to see this lovely woman who runs this program. And she said to me, this looks like something that might come under sociology. and there's a guy you should talk to. I said, okay, fine. She picked up the phone. She called over to the College of Technology. And this guy happened to be in his office. And he said, yeah, send that guy over. So I walked over just out of nowhere, right? And I sat down with him and I gave him this sheet of paper. And he was reading it. And I said, you know, the only thing is, I don't know what to call this. And he said, well, I'm a sociologist. And in sociology, we call this organizational development. And I said, you mean there are other people who are interested in this? He said, oh, yeah, it's a whole discipline. I went, wow, I never knew that. You know, this is clueless Ken. I've gone into the world with no idea so many times. And he said, yeah, yeah, and you should take my class in complex organizations. And I said to him, well, I tried to sign up for that, but it was full. And he said, you should take my class. And I said, it's full. He said, you don't understand. I'm your professor. If I say you should take the class, and this should resonate with you because I'm paying it forward right now with you two guys. He said, you should take my class. I said, okay, I'll take your class. And then he said the most astonishing thing. He said, you should help me teach it. You know, because I was like much older than his other students. And it turned out that he wanted to go to France and he needed somebody to fill in. And I looked maybe like maybe I knew something and maybe I looked old enough so that it was credible and he could go to France. And that is how my career as a lecturer at the university level began, in just that way. There's no plan here, you know, and that was 30 years ago. And I have been doing this ever since. I've also done other stuff, but I have been always teaching in some way or the other, unless I got fired and then there was interruption, but that only happened a couple of times. So.
Yeah, we're curious as to, you know, obviously we've been in your class this past semester. How do you determine, you know, your teaching methods or styles? Because obviously, you know, yours is not a classic Canvas format where you have assignments tab, syllabus tab. Ours is kind of like more free flowing. So how do you determine those methods of teaching?
Well, you know, I have told you before that I was a terrible student. I only learned the things that I want to learn. I've always been like that. I was never successful as a student. I managed barely to get out of high school. I got thrown out of college 5 or 6 times, you know, all of that kind of stuff. And then when this accident happened, that I found myself, I filled in for this guy at Eastern, and then I team taught with him one semester, and then they gave me a section of my own to teach. And like everyone else, you know, if you don't get a chance to do stuff, and all of a sudden you're standing there in front of 30 people, and you go, you know, what, now what, right? And so I did what everybody else had done, which was the usual stuff that you just mentioned, Christian. And so I gave everybody at some point an exam. And here's the question. I want you to answer the question based on what I told you about this, you know, 3 weeks ago. And so I get all of these handwritten blue books back from my students. And I sat down to grade them. And I realized if I read 3 or 4 of these horribly written, the handwriting was awful. And everybody was answering the question in the same way. And I said, you know, this is boring the shit out of me. I hate this. And then I soldiered through that. And then I had this thought, you know, Ken, you've always hated this. It drives you nuts. Nothing much happens here. And then I thought, well, what would it be like to have a class that you, Ken, would take that would be interesting to you? And that was the moment. I thought, oh, yeah, because nobody really cares what I do in this classroom. You know, they're getting their tuition money. I'm teaching this class for social work and criminal justice majors. They have to take this class. And so I realized that, you know, I mean, I could try stuff. And I started to try stuff. And it sort of evolved from there, where I didn't want to teach about dead white guys. You know, I wanted students to actually learn something. And I thought if you did stuff, maybe you'd learn more. And so I started down this path of just doing stuff, you know, here, let's do this. You know, I was teaching complex organizations. And what does that mean? You know, what, how do you ask the big questions, right? How do you know anything about that? And I thought, you know, I know a lot about this stuff because I've been on the wrong side of organizations my whole life. You know, from the time I was 4 years old, I was in trouble in organizations. And so I started to get savvy about that. You know, I was fighting them all the time. And that's what I knew. And I said, and because I had started, you know, various ventures and stuff like that, I said to my students at one point, well, okay, I want you to create your own organization. That's how you learn, right? You have to figure out what the parts are, or the, all that kind of stuff. So we created all kinds of organizations in the classroom. You know, we said, well, you know a lot about schools, so create a school that you would go to, right? Create a school district that you would go to. See how the complexities start to mount. Create a government. And so we started to do that. And over a long period of time, I started to do more and more of that, and always on the basis of what kind of a class would I still like to be in? You know, where it was, there was enough meat to get involved with. There was enough stuff. And only in the last few years have I really, and the pandemic had something to do with this, have I really pushed this idea of opening up the doors as wide as possible for people to learn things that they really care about and then share it back. And so that's where, you know, a lot of the assignments that you've done with me are based on that. Like, you do something that you actually want to learn, or that is interesting enough that you don't know anything about. And you go, well, all right, that looks like it might be fun. You know, I don't know anything about Japanese woodworking or bamboo or any of that other stuff. So I'll go do that, you know, and then I'll write something about it. And it turns out that that works pretty well. So that's, you know, and I've written about this in various places. I don't really have any colleagues to speak of. They think I'm nuts. You know, they're all driven by other things, but every once in a while I run into somebody, and I'm also part of a very large tradition that goes back a long way that is about alternative education. You know, I started a school once for kids who couldn't go to school. And this was all based on guys like A.S. Neal, who wrote a book called Summerhill, and he founded a school. Who is it? It's Ken Robinson, who just died not long ago, who was also a brilliant educator, who was actually concerned about people learning, not getting credentialed, but real learning. I have a son-in-law who founded a preschool. It's based on these kinds of ideas. But in the mainstream, it's the stuff that you're talking about, Christian, that basically I think bores the crap out of everybody, wastes a lot of time, and we could do this a lot better and a lot faster with a whole lot more fun if we did it differently.
Absolutely. So, yeah. Yeah, I think you know, more general class styles, you kind of, like you said, you learn material from the teacher in a lecture or whatever, and you just kind of answer questions off exams, but in your class, you kind of digest that information from online, the stuff you enjoy learning about, and then you reciprocate it by teaching other people about it, and it kind of cements that knowledge inside of you. And I think it's something that's really, you know, helped me get a better understanding of things in this world that I really didn't know about.
Well, you know, you guys are in a lot of ways, you're big time soccer players, you know, to play at the level that you play at. And if you look at that and you go, how did I stay motivated for all these years? Right. And I will tell you how. At some moment, you fell in love. And no matter how tough it was, no matter how arduous it was, winning and losing, you know, you were in love and you kept pushing yourselves to get better. You kept driving yourselves to learn more and more about this thing that you loved. And all the rest of your life is infused with what you have learned as soccer players. You see the world in lots of complex ways because you come at the thing that you do so passionately. And you bring that into everything else that you do. And I can see no good reason why we couldn't do school like that. I mean, imagine this, where everything that you do, you get up in the morning and you go, wow, it's a school day. You know, I'm gonna learn cool shit today. I care about all of this kind of stuff, right? That's what I've been working on for a long, long time. I can't say that I'm getting very far, but I keep trying because, like you, I love this. You know, this drives me that I want it to work so badly. I want to be the best that I can at this. And I don't have any models, you know. There's no Lionel Messi for me, right? I go, who do I model myself after? You know, and I'm such an eccentric guy that you know, even if there were somebody, it would be different. So that's the basis of it, you know. If you can create environments in which people can explore things, as we do, and maybe fall in love, right? And you could start this like in the third grade or earlier. My son-in-law does this with 3 to 6-year-olds. You know, he creates these environments that they love. And they fall in love with things all the time. And it's not punitive, and they're not graded, and they're not judged. You know, they're celebrated, and they're learning monsters. And you know, he's doing on one end of the spectrum what I'm trying to do at the other end. And then there's this great void in the middle somehow that I don't know what to do with. But so there's that.
Yeah.
I feel like it's crazy how once you find something that you actually love to do, I can motivate and push you. At least like for me, I grew up playing soccer ever since I can walk. And like, there's so many moments and memories that I just remember distinctly just because I enjoyed liking my time there. And whereas, for example, in school, I kind of mostly remember my friends and like rather than what was taught, what was learned. For those of you that don't know, Ken's class is, we submit our assignments on Facebook. So like this whole interaction. So when me, three of the men's soccer team are in the class and we first heard about this, we were like, what is this? This is a first. Like we had no idea what to expect. And I mean, as of right now, it's probably the class that we've talked about the most.
Yeah.
In terms of like interactions with each other and like, oh, what did we do today for Ken's class? Or like just the interaction, the overall like openness of the class. We haven't seen something like that. Mm-hmm. So definitely sparked the interest in a way.
Well, it's music to my ears, you know. I can stand anything but indifference.